atmosphere outside. It's nice. It will really be nice about 2 o'clock. The Veterans Parade is today because it's a Veterans Day parade. And, of course, Brother Melvin is always right in the middle of that. His brother's going to be with him. I think, Frank, all three of you are going to be riding. I'm going to try to get some pictures of him at $20 a piece.
Hey, Neil, my cup's up there between
the Lord's good.
Amen.
Right here in the middle. Thank you.
Never met anybody like him.
Amen.
Don't want to lose his favor. I won't lose it. He's just really faithful. Wow. He is so faithful.
So, supposedly, it's going to start off with the kids.
He always treats us right. Better than
JB and I, CJ and I are going to say, I trust in God. Shy may or may not join us. She may or may not sing her song. And Lee is going to sing. And I don't know if the pastor's going to sing.
Yeah, he's saying.
You need to give me $10. I won't get it, but that's okay. The Lord will get you. Well, praise the Lord. We're getting ready to worship here. Miss Mary is here. We're going to count her twice today.
Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
All right. Well, turn around and hug somebody's neck. We kind of hate to do that. Some people don't hug necks. And some people are too good at wearing necks.
Bless you, man. Bless you.
All in between.
Bless you. Bless you. Bless you.
I just want you to know when you're sitting in your seat, she made us a move.
I need to find shoes, just like
that. Okay, Miss Iris is going to share with us while we're waiting on the young folks are going to kick it off today. They did such a great job last Sunday. Wow, didn't they? Okay, Miss Iris.
Good morning, everybody. I want to go over a few of the really important things, and they probably are in your bulletin to remind you of them. But we are looking for somebody to take over our is that bad? I hold it up. We're looking for someone to take over our one call. Miss Barbara does that, but as her husband needs more help, we're trying to free up some of her time, so she needs someone that would be willing to take the prayer request and put them on the one call for us. Okay. Tracy said she would do that for you, so she can see you after service. Great, wonderful. Okay, some of the other things that we need to cover, the global outreach missions. We're less than halfway. I don't know where we're at, but maybe Barbara can give us, see what kind of push we got to do towards the end of the year about our missions, our gift given, to see where we're at. The last time we checked, the middle of the year, or I think July, we were less than halfway. So we got some push to do with that. And we did talk to Prophet Eddie this past week, and he misses everybody. He sounds like he's doing really good. They are having services in his church, even though they don't have the roof on yet. They are having services, and he has sent a letter to IPH Missions to see if maybe his church in Ghana can join with IPH. So I'm hoping this will happen for him. So y'all keep that in prayer for Brother Prophet Eddie. Spirit Life Fall Retreat. As you know, because of the storm we had, they canceled the retreat. It's like a 3-day retreat up in the mountains. So what they're going to do is have it as a 1-day. It'll start at 9. We have to be at 9:30. Check in by 9. It's $5 at the door. We will meet at the Spirit Life Conference Campgrounds. Starts at 9:30 and it goes to about 1:30 or 2, something like that. It's a 1-day event, but the $5 registration fee, that's going to cover your meal and the speaker that we're having, and I think it'll be a great day. So I need to know today if you can go this coming Saturday. And we can carpool. Thank you, Rejoice. I'm glad you're going. I'll be going. So please let me know today if you can go.
All ladies are welcome.
I have to let them know tomorrow. I have to give them our names and just the number so they can be prepared for the meal. District Pastors Dinner Meeting. We're having one more for the end of the year, and it's going to be not this Tuesday, but Tuesday week. So I have got a sign-up sheet being passed around somewhere. Okay, Barbara has it now, but keep passing it. And it's got ingredients for us to do a taco salad bar for the pastors and ministers. And instead of us having a service on Wednesday night and having this on Tuesday night, we're just going to combine them. So everyone from the church will be invited. And this list right here, if you can contribute something on that list, it will help keep our costs down. And the ministers, all the ministers and pastors and their wives, Spirit Life Ministry will reimburse us for that. So that will be a check coming back to the church. So you're helping your church out when you're helping for this event that's coming up. But if you can bring your item by next Sunday, then I will know what else I need to add to it or get it prepared for Tuesday night. This is going to be the 12th, November the 12th. So if you bring your item on the clipboard that's passed around, if you bring it next Sunday when you come to church, then it'll be here for us to prepare on Tuesday. Sharon Pentecostal Church is having something, and I think that is, that's the 23rd. That's the same, 21st, or that's on a Saturday. Sharon Pentecostal is having, I guess it's their women's ministry meeting, and they're having a meal. I don't know all the details about it, but if you go, you need to take a covered dish with you. They always have a nice event and speaker there. We have joined them a few times, so this is a possibility that we may do this. This is on November the 23rd, and it's in your bulletin to remind you. The Sunday after that Saturday, the 24th, that's the last Sunday before Thanksgiving, and that's when we have our Thanksgiving meal for the church. So you'll be, we all need to prepare dishes for that too, for our Thanksgiving meal. Our grief group that we have every month, this past month, I believe we had about 17 people there. It's growing. It's been really good. We had some new people. I think about 3 new people that came this past month. We normally do it on the second Thursday, but we're changing to the first Thursday for this month due to a conflict in the schedule. But the grief group will meet this coming Thursday, November the 7th at 10:30. And I believe we are having a salad bar. Is that what we're doing? And we've got to where we didn't start out doing this, but now we all bring a little something, whether we're having a salad bar or sandwiches, and just throw it in the pile and everybody eats together. So it's an enjoyable time. I believe I said enough.
Amen. Praise the Lord. That's really nice when women say that, isn't it? Whoa. I better hit the altar, haven't I, Byron? You're not praying for me, are you?
I am. All the time.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. No, my dear wife, what a blessing she is. Okay, we're going to start with some music now. Come on, guys, and hit the stage, but not too hard. Miss Debbie, you go ahead and start us off. You want to? Oh, they're up there. Wow. Well, shoot, shucks, John Brown, and all the other wonderful words. Okay. And we'll stand up in a little bit. Yeah, we got 2 singers here.
My name's J.D.
And what grade are you?
11.
Okay.
Hey. I'm Shy, his older sister. I'm 20. I'm the one with the baby. And I'm a freshman in college.
Wow.
Ladies and gentlemen, we want you to understand that when you have professionals, they have to take their time to get it right. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
And we're not going to have no junk around here. And these kids, they don't believe in any junk. They're going to put it down, and then put it out again.
Amen.
So we're going to hang in there with them, and we're so glad that they're here. How about you? Amen.
Unloaded and put it in the church and was able to help
you know, sort of and everything, but my daughter heard the pastor telling another lady, this was a good haul. And she said that they could really use everything that they got. So thank you. They said to say thank you to you, to everybody that gave.
Amen.
To bless you.
Yeah, there's a good bit of stuff kept coming through the fellowship hall there that went. Yeah, it was. I was impressed and proud, and some good stuff. They right here, some good stuff. Yeah, a mattress, etc. Blow ups. Well, thank the Lord for that. Aren't we wonderful people? We're wonderfully blessed. No need to be stressed. No need to be humble in the wrong way. Be proud in the right way. There's a right way to be proud, and there's the wrong way to be humble. Amen?
Yeah.
Am I getting too deep for you?
Yeah.
Are you struggling or troubling, or are you somewhere lost your way down the line? Well, how about us take up an offering that'll help you, you think? Don't you think? Now, we love any kind of money we get, but we especially love green. There's just something about green that blesses the church and blesses the pastor and blesses you, that you can afford the green stuff. But we'll take anything. One lady got by with two mites about the weight of two or three potato chips, and she's been on record ever since for the gift that she gave in the name of the Lord. Jesus called it out. She will always be remembered for what she did in presenting that gift to the Lord. Amen. Okay, here they come, two handsome young men. Got any girlfriends yet, guys? Good. Good. Your mama's doing good. I don't know what she told you, but it's working. Thanks, Mama.
I said, let's not go there.
Oh, we will not. We have left. We're coming to take an offering, and let's bless the Lord with it. Lord, we thank you for the privilege to present to you a sacrifice for some more than others. For not only the gift that's a part of being a part of the kingdom, but also the gift that we add on to that. And so we bless all that we receive in your name and for your glory, for it is your name. And we do this to honor you as a sacrifice that you gave for us. It's just a substitute, a small one, but we bless it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Back.
And you know why I'm back? Because somebody prayed for me.
Amen.
And I was trying to decide yesterday. I was standing in the kitchen and I was singing one song after another. And then when I'd go to the part I was supposed to sing with, you know, without the demonstration, without that part. With the person, I could sing okay, but when it got to me to do it, I was like, man, I have lost my voice. And I want to share this with you. If you have a gift, I don't care if it's getting on your knees and praying or what that gift is, if you don't use it, you will lose it.
Amen.
And I'm serious. And I haven't been singing. I don't even hardly turn the radio on. I do when I'm traveling, and I'll try to get a station on them back roads. But anyway, I do want to tell you all that I appreciate every prayer that you breathe for me. I haven't been in the hospital or had surgery or anything like that for a long time, since 2016. And I certainly haven't been, I wasn't married for a long time before I had a husband. And it was really a challenge. Without prayer, I probably wouldn't be standing up here. I'd be in a nut house somewhere. I don't do well as the patient because I'm a caregiver. And I expect my caregiver to be like me. Well, guess what? They're not. So I know prayer got me through. And the person that needed to pray for me the most, believe it or not, was me. I had to pray for me, and I prayed myself out of the deepest valley I have been in, but God. He heard every one of them, and when I didn't see it right then, because I write my prayers in a book, I could go back and I could see He is moving. He is doing things. And then I could see results in other ways, and I'd give God the glory for it, because I had to pray for myself, but there was a time in my life, and I call this song my testimony song, Somebody Pray for Me, because I've been in a valley before that was way deeper than this one I just went through. Nothing will hold a candle to that one, because when you're at the point that you want to take your life, I think that's as low as you can go.
Yeah.
When you're really serious about it, that's a deep, dark place to be. And so I knew somebody prayed me right out of it, and I had the evidence of it. So when you see the evidence of the somebody prayed for you because they called you out and they were a stranger to you, you know then. It's like when Sister Charlene is coming and she'll prophesy over somebody. It's like, how did she know that? Well, you know how she knew it. God gave her that. So that's what happened to me, and you never forget it. You never forget being prophesied over, especially when it comes to fruition or it spared your life. Because you know where you were, and you know that only God got you out, and somebody. So, hit it.
Parade began at Calvary. dawning of that day. This could be the dawning of that grand and glorious day, when the face of Jesus will be whole. Dreams and hopes of all the ages are awaiting His returning, and this could be the dawning of that day. All the saints are getting restless. They're not bound by shackles forged of earthly gold. Since that day they knelt at Calvary, they've been pilgrims ever wandering, just looking for a place to rest their soul. This could be the dawning of that grand and glorious day, when the face of Jesus will be whole. Dreams and hopes of all the ages are awaiting His returning, and this could be the dawning of that day. This could be the dawning of that day. Until then, my heart would go on singing. Until then, my joy I'll carry on. Dreams and hopes of all the ages are awaiting His returning, and this could be the dawning of that day. This could be the dawning of that day.
Is wonderful. We're going to be having communion in just a little bit, and I'm going to share with you some. Last Sunday we got together, Brother James and I, for a little session here about the situation and the kingdom, and especially the Jezebel spirit. And it's not just a singular kind of thing, you know, in a small location, located in the mountains or located in California. I'm sure some lost. I better back up. There's a lot in California, a lot of places on the north coast, the east coast, the west coast, the south coast, and the battle is on. It's not. I remember it's been 20 years or so ago that I was preaching at 96, and I just stopped and said there had just been released a bunch of demons out of hell.
Amen.
And all along the way, that's been going on. You see, we had enough enforcements and reinforcements in the United States of America to quiet it down quite a bit. They didn't have the authority, but we gave them that authority. We opened doors that should never have been opened. Some of them are no doubt through telephone, through television, through classrooms, through just an immorality that's been overwhelming in so many ways. Not that it hasn't happened before. England, when that revival came, they were hanging 10-year-olds. It just got so bad. So it's been some bad times before, but we're living in a time where the warfare of two kingdoms are going on in a very drastic way. The problem is that the kingdom of darkness seemed to be more energized than the kingdom of righteousness. Now, it seems that way. It always seems that way when the kingdom of God's involved. He lets it happen, I guess. He just, in other words, when he gets in the battle, he nails it. He nails it, and he takes some screws, and he screws it on in, and then he nails it to where it will be remembered, just as the nails on that tree has made an impact forever, and we are enjoying the benefits of the covering of what he did by taking our place. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
So we're in kingdoms. Now, we didn't talk much about, a whole lot about kingdoms. I know I'm a citizen of a new world is a song that we, of two worlds, that's right, a citizen of two worlds. We're citizens of the two worlds. And both of them are good in a way. But one of them is great and one of them has its good stuff because it's good to be part of a citizen of the United States of America. It's good to be. But now we're at the place where we have got to be serious about the kingdom.
Amen.
We've got to be serious about the kingdom of God.
Yes.
We've got to be serious about the kingdom of darkness that is encroaching on our territory.
Amen.
It's come a lot. Listen, in the last 5 years, the devil has gained so much ground in the school system and gained a whole lot of ground in the church. And the battle, not that so much bad stuff is going on in the church, it's just that he has been able to take some things from us that we let him take that we should have kept, and we did not. He took away a lot of prayers. He took away the desire to be in the house of God for so many. It doesn't really matter whether people are in the house or not. It's not a priority. It's just another list of things we do. And the kingdom of God is not that way for sure. And the church of the living God, with the church of the living, it cannot. I'm going to tell you, it's a sin to miss church. It's a sin to, I mean, you know, the times are all of us have to go, but it's a sin to miss church.
Amen.
You don't believe it is? You know it is. You know, so Laodicea, you know, they had church, but it wasn't what church ought to be.
Amen.
And Ephesus, they had good church, but they lost the spirit, the ghost. They lost the spirit. They backslid.
Yeah.
They weren't out fornicating. They were still going through all the motions. But when it gets to where we're all only going through the motions, we have fallen away.
Amen.
It doesn't mean we're going to hell. It just means we have drifted. We have fallen away.
Amen.
Because you see, when the church doesn't move, a current will move us.
Yeah.
If you get out in the ocean, and I read this in Reader's Digest or somewhere, but this fellow down on the other side of what is it called? There's a couple of wonderful places to go and have a vacation. You go snorkeling, and it's down on close to Mexico. It's on the shoreline there, and so they were having a good time. This two friends. They were having a good time, their families were, and they decided to go out and ride the jet skis. And one of the men didn't want to, but he was talked into it, so he went and he went riding with him. Well, his jet ski tore up, and he hated to leave it there in the water, and his friend said, "Here, jump on the back of mine, and we'll go back and tell him." He says, "No, I'm just hanging there with you." Well, he hung in there with it. When the man came to help, he was so far drifted away that when they finally got him, a ship picked him up 200 miles out in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. Because he had drifted that far. The last stage that happened was it sank and it grabbed that top seat off so he could float. And a man just providentially saw him out among the waves. And when they brought him, he said, "In," he said, You have no idea how you could have been missed. Because so you look at those waves. There's no way I should have been able to see you, but I saw you. And so I'm saying, you know, we drifted some, but somebody's still watching out for us. We coming back. We coming home. Somebody say, the prodigals are coming home. The halfway prodigals and the quarter prodigals and the one, the eighth of prodigals, they are coming home. Can you say, man, that the church is coming back in favor and the kingdom of God is beginning to rear up and help the church? Now, the church, the kingdom, when I talk about kingdom, it's what I'm learning more and more, and I know Byron's studied, but it's one of them things that is almost a lifetime adventure, and I haven't really gotten into it, and I'm still picking up stuff and still learning things about the kingdom of God. We understand a lot about the kingdom of darkness, but the kingdom of God, it is a big deal, and we need to treat it like it is. It is a big deal. Now, it's a kingdom you can't all and often can't see. It's a kingdom that's within us. It's a kingdom you have if you want it. It's a, you can be in the church and not have the kingdom of heart that you ought to have. You have to make a choice to do that. The kingdom is a big time choice. Say, listen, I want more. I don't want just to get by. I want the big playground. I looked in one of the really old type commentaries, and this brilliant man was pictured it this way. He said, the church and the kingdom of God is like two circles that intertwine. Said one of them is a smaller circle, the church. The church is the bride. It's not a real big circle. There's not a whole bunch of people in the bride. There's the one circle, little circle, and then there is a big circle, and they kind of intertwine. And so what we have now in a new sense, in a new way, we're having to understand that the kingdom of God's business is to energize the church. And it is the church's business to send out the missionaries and to do the other things. And it's the kingdom's church is to make things that used to be so much of a big deal. When the kingdom church is involved, the little stuff's not a big deal.
Amen.
Little problems are not a big deal. Because in the church that has been, little things can... One church split over a screen door. One church... Lord have mercy, help us all. That shows you how far that we can go in the flesh. And the flesh is more... It's worse than any other product of producing sin than other the devil himself. The flesh is the stuff that gets us. The devil doesn't have to send many demons. We got enough of meanness in us by ourselves. We're contrary enough. We're stubborn as all get out, get up and get on and get off of it. That's just the way we are. So the business of the kingdom, as far as I can see it and understanding, is that the kingdom now in this season with two kingdoms going has really got to kind of rev up the church, and the church has got to rev up towards the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is massive. Remember, you've got to circle the Old Testament and all the Jewish Christians and all the stuff that goes along with it. It is a circle bigger than you can see. And we are the church. The church, we studied it in the book of Revelation. There's several church ages, several churches that have different responsibilities and different problems. And right in the middle of that is the Jezebel spirit in one of them stirring things up. And it's not one lonely woman doing that.
Amen.
It is a herd of it. I mean, it is as if there's been a great regiment joining daily in the spirit of Jezebel, the controlling spirit, the intimidating spirit, the seducing spirit, the spirit of Antichrist, the spirit that reaches out to grab everything it can get and take it in. It's like a big alligator. He's hungry, and he wants it all.
Amen.
And the devil's in that process. He's out to devour everything that he can. That's a known fact. And he's now not as polished. He may not be as polished as he used to be, but he's more persistent and more able to go forward in a radically public way to do what he wants to do. So we're living in that stage and in that... But listen, we got the kingdom of God.
Yes.
You know? And this just has really started rolling. It's only been rolling now about 4,000 years to some extent, you know. It's been rolling since the cross was considered the point that's going to keep everything square and keep everything together. And that particular truth, even in the beginning of time, was understood. And it's kind of kept us going and still keeping us around, keeping us from losing it all. This is what's keeping us from losing it all, what he did. The Lord Jesus Christ, I want to tell you, he's good. I want to tell you, when you're in a fuss with him, you're in a fuss that you're going to lose. You'll walk away so embarrassed that you won't know what to say, but Lord God, forgive me, I have been an idiot. And the Lord said, yes, son, you're an idiot, but you're a saved idiot. So the kingdom of God is just a little tad on that. What I'm thinking about is this. I'm thinking about it, the kingdom of God, in the sense of it being a zone. Let me talk to you a little bit about zones. And I think the kingdom of God and zones go together good. And I told you that story about Tuscata over in Siberia in 1919 on June the 30th, that this 300 diameter rock came through and it killed out 88 million trees. It killed all kinds of reindeer. There weren't many people, but there were a whole lot of reindeer, but it just cleaned them out by the hundreds. Just that 300-pound rock, about 3 miles above Earth, they say, between 3 and 6 miles, it cleared out 800 square miles. 800 square miles. Just swept by, and just a little rock in the sky compared to the universe, and it took some things down. Well, you could use that for the devil, but I'm going to use it for the Lord. Is that all right? He can take things down too. This one little cross here, oh, well, it packs a powwow. I'm telling you, it can move things. It can deliver. It can change things. It can get rid of people. I mean, the kingdom of God can get rid of people. I don't mean we should pray against people. Well, maybe we should. But pray against the Spirit and let the Lord take care of what it takes to get done what we're asking Him to do for His glory and His honor and for His name's sake.
Amen.
Yeah. Matter of fact, the prayer that we pray, the Lord taught us to pray. He said, our Father in heaven, give us this day our daily bread. Thy kingdom come. Wait, I got it backwards. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done. Thy kingdom come, he says. And what we're saying when we say it, that thy kingdom, we're saying we want to be under your leadership, your kingship.
Amen.
We're praying that we can be a part of you being the king. That's the kingdom we want. We want you king. We don't want Prophet Eddie or Prophet Elijah or Pastor Ben or, you know, all the other things that are so vital and important that we need in the kingdom of God, we need that. But we got to have the king. As long as we got the king, there's more than just hope. It's a so going to be kind of thing that the Lord is going and is doing even now. We see it here in the town, and a lot of people haven't gotten in on what God is doing, but God is doing things, and they're not only here in Greenwood, but it's doing it over at Grace, and those of us that get to go, and others that probably need to go. Those services have been great. Friday night was an awesome service. So the issue is that now we can't just, even though I'm enjoying sitting down and watching stuff. I like to watch here preach. I like other stuff, you know. I like that stuff. And it's addictive. This is addictive to chocolate, and you can't be more addicted than it is to chocolate. My mama was a chocoholic. She didn't know she needed to be delivered. She died a chocoholic. Yeah. But the time is now. Now, okay, let me go in and say that. So the move of God. Let me talk to you about, well, just an example of fishing zone. I can quit pretty quick. I've been in a fishing zone. Now this happened. My brother took me out in the backwaters over in North Carolina on Pamlico Sound, and he took me in the backwaters, and I'm not a great fisherman, but something happened. I went into a zone. I hit a zone. I looked up, and there's him about five or six, not canes, but he had five or six baits along the way, already tied up and ready to go. And I looked up, and I saw a bait that had a glow. I kid you not. I looked up. I said, "What's going on here? This bait has got a glow." And he said, "Which one of these poles do you want?" I said, "I want that one. I want that one." And you know, I got into that thing, and everybody out there fishing was watching me, and I didn't know anything. I was catching the redfish, and I was catching the speckled trout. I was catching them right away, and I wasn't fishing, but I knew somebody helped me. I knew somebody brought me out of that boat and energized me, and I went into a zone. I mean, and I knew God did it for me. He knew I needed that. My brother caught so many fish, and I'm glad I put the daylights out of him one time in it before he died. And so I was in the zone. I hit a zone. I said, "Whoa." And the kingdom is like that. If you can't get in a continuous zone, and some people have been successful to produce that. But most of us don't stay in it very long. We kind of skin it. But listen, if you just skin it, it'll get you done. It'll get you there where you need to go. That pole's yours, and it's shining. It's saying, "Listen, I got you, boy, and I'm going to take you to a new level. You didn't know you were going to this level of fishing. They think you've been practicing. They think you ought to be on TV the way you were fishing." I mean, my brother couldn't even get him out of the boat. Get him in the boat. He got a really big one in the boat and knocked it up overboard, and I smacked him. No, I didn't. So I know what it is to get into a zone.
Amen, brother. Come on.
The lady who played the piano is Sister White for many years at the church. She played the piano over there. I think her last name was White.
You talking about Edith Jones?
Jones, yes. Well, I married her because she wanted somebody for Providence. And she probably should have been dead a long time before, because here's what happened. And I told it on her, and others told it. She was driving up towards the airport with a friend. And you know, there's a zone up there you're not supposed to get in. She got in it. She went in where the airplanes were. She got out on, I guess, the tarmac. She got out there. This white-headed lady was driving that car around inside, not in the parking lot. No, she was over there by the planes. She was. I mean, you know, sometimes it's all right to be in a zone, but that's not the zone you want.
Amen.
Everybody's in some kind of zone, and the devil's in some kind of zone. He's high as a kite, and the enemy is as high as a kite. The politics for some is as high as a kite for what they may want to do in line with the enemy. It's all over the world. There's a zone. There's some zones all around, but I choose my zone.
Amen.
I choose the kingdom of God for its righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. That's the zone I want. I choose that zone. There's some other zones you can get in, and some people who used to be in that zone have traded for another zone because they got the temptation that just suited their fancy right, and the privilege that they had of being in that kingdom of God's anointing and victory and overcoming is out of sight. I listened to this soldier, the story about this soldier, and he was out in among the bushes, and all of his comrades that was shooting and blowing up things. It was just wild there. But he said, "I got in a zone." And I had no fear. And I could hear the boom over here to the left, the pop over there. It was all going on. The war was going on, but I just got in the zone. I was not worried. I was not nervous. And I was not anxious.
Amen.
Out there in the middle of shots going left, right, over his head, around him, he wasn't worried one bit. It wasn't because he was brave. He just got in the zone.
Amen.
He just got in the zone. Now, we're not brave, that brave brother. We just need someone to get us in the zone. And you see these little fellas, if you get them in the zone, they'll whoop a big guy.
Amen.
Listen, I've learned that you don't never fight anybody smaller than you because you look bad. Always find something big. It's better to get a couple black eyes by somebody bigger than you for getting two black eyes from somebody 2 feet shorter than you are. I wrestled a boy about that. Sure, it really embarrassed me. So getting in the zone is a big deal. Finding the zone is a big deal. God has zones. He has revivals. He has times that he visits. He visited me right up here one time. It wasn't three seconds long, but he visited me right here. It was on a Wednesday night about 5:30, and Sister Dolores was on the other side praying. I was in the zone. It's time to get in the zone.
Amen.
It's time to shake it off. Shake hell off and put heaven on.
Amen.
Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh.
Amen.
I say it's time to get in the zone. Somebody agree with me.
Amen.
It's time to get in the zone. It's time to look in places we haven't looked before, because the kingdom of God is available. Here's what the kingdom of God does for the church. And I'll just restate it and I'm about done. But what the kingdom of God that Paul preached, that Jesus definitely preached, what it does was it, things that used to be a big deal to us, and I reiterate it, it seemed to be a really big deal, a mountain that seemed to be this way up there, when you get in the zone, you find yourself looking down on that mountain. Because that's just the way the kingdom works. You'll be looking up, Lord, at somebody with cancer, somebody with no eyeballs, somebody that's lost his limbs, lost his toes, lost his feet, and all of a sudden he's standing up walking. And after a while, nothing is a big deal anymore.
Amen.
It's just normal for those kinds of things to happen.
Yeah.
When it got to where it wasn't normal anymore, nothing began to happen. But when it got to where we just knew there was nothing to it and God was going to do it, it always happens on Sunday, at least 2 Sundays a week or 3 Sundays a month. We just knew it was going to happen, and brother, it did happen just like we thought it was, because we got back in the zone that we need to be in. Somebody shout and praise the Lord. I remember shouting until 11 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
Calling somebody out so drunk. Oh, it's wonderful to be drunk. And it's all right. The kingdom it is.
Yeah.
And the kingdom is righteousness, joy, and peace. It's eating and drinking is a part of it. Eating and drinking is a part of the kingdom. I don't mean bad stuff. I'm just saying partying is kingdom stuff.
Amen.
Partying is one of the enemy has part. They go away getting run over with machetes cutting their head off, and oh, they party. They party, roll heads instead of bowling. I'd rather go bowling. Rolling heads. But if you in the kingdom of God, you're having a genuine old-fashioned party that when you lay down and wake up the next morning, you feel like you haven't done anything all day and you're ready to go to work because you're in the zone. You see, we're not in this thing for ourselves to get something done. We're here as available to the Lord Jesus Christ, and God's not going to do what needs to be done until we get to where we need to be, because God has made it up in such a way that he's given us a responsibility that is not his in the world.
That's right.
We're given a responsibility that's not his, and sometimes he intercepts and goes in the zone.
Yeah.
But as a rule, he has plans for us to be in the zone that it takes. The spirit that he has, we have.
Yeah.
The power that is in him, he lets it be available to us by choice. He planned it that way. That's what the cross is for. We couldn't have that kind of value, those kind of gifts, if it weren't for the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, if it wasn't for the power of the Holy Ghost, the power of the Spirit. If it wasn't for that, we could not make it. But because we can look like big hot dogs, I'm telling you right now, at the fair. Praise the Lord. I don't know where that came from. I'm in a zone, okay? I'm in a little bit of a zone. Will you get in the zone with me?
Amen.
You get in the zone. You know when people start dancing, they're in a zone. When an old man like me starts dancing, you know he's in the zone. Doesn't mean I'm necessarily ready to hug my wife. I'm ready. But you get in the zone and things change in you.
That's right.
Yes.
I remember shouting one time, I looked like one of those idiots, I said. And I don't mind saying an idiot because I consider myself an idiot, but a sanctified idiot, a tool that God can use, idiot. Amen. He uses idiots sometimes better than does those calm people.
Yeah.
He uses crazy people, that's the thing.
Crazy
people, always been crazy. Always got into stuff, out of stuff, through stuff. And God anoints me. So, but I'm going to just anoint him like he is and see what he can do in the kingdom. And actually, he's decided he can do something with me. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
He lifted me up. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. I'm here to stay. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
He's ordained me, placed me. The apostle over there, he's not an apostle because he decided to be. He was ordained there. And I recognize that. It's something that he offers. Doesn't mean he goes around saying, I'm an apostle. I don't go around saying, I'm Reverend Ben Edwards. I'm ready, Ben Edwards. I said, if you'll take me to lunch, you can call me Boss Hall. And I'll be all right.
Yes,
oh, God's so good.
Amen.
I say, God's so good.
Amen.
Why are you worried? You in the kingdom, brother and sister.
Yes.
He's dragging you more into more knowledge, more into more spaces. He's setting you up for revelation. Everybody's got a right by the cross to have some great revelations. I'm talking about everybody. I'm not just talking about the prophet or anyone else. In there. God can give anybody who gets in the zone stuff that they would never get. They'll get stuff that some of the big-time prophets can't give.
Amen.
He just likes to do that. He says he likes to take some little runt and that little kid. Did you know in some of our history, there is, in I think it was the French Christians, the Huguenots. They had babies 2 years old prophesy in the crib. In the crib, they were prophesying things full of the Holy Ghost. And just barely, not even out of the crib, maybe 2 years old. Of course, that's a long time to be in a crib. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You think God's too big for God? Well, we can agree with that half-heartedly. Sometimes we think, now I've asked God to do that, but I don't know if he can do that or not. You ever felt that way? You didn't say that. You said, I also thank God you did, but you thought it's too big even for God. He gives promises that are too big. He wants you to ask big. And I'll quit here.
Yes.
I'll quit here. The great French, when Napoleon, he had one taken over an island, and a good friend of mine, Brother Phillips, I heard him say this at a meeting. He's a great minister and a great leader. His son's a great pastor. And this book private comes up to one of the leaders, one of the generals, and, sir, I'd like to talk to General Napoleon. He said, what do you want to talk for him? I just want to ask him for something. And Napoleon said, let him ask him. Let him ask him. He said, sir, I just request that you give me this island. And everybody, this boy's crazy. Napoleon's going to give this buck, he barely can polish his shoes. And he wants this island. Napoleon gave it to him. He couldn't turn it down. He said, he honored me by the size of his request.
Amen.
And sometimes we're dishonoring God because we're just not asking him big enough.
Amen.
We're not, and so some good kingdom of God wind blowing through the place, brother, all of a sudden you're going to see the weirdest, wildest stuff you've ever seen in your life. And some of us are just being left here so we can see it happen. He's extending lives in this place and other places so that we people can see it because we've been needed. We're not ostracized by God. He has chosen us to use us in these last days like he's never done in any other generation before in the United States of America. We're called out of God to do something. Come on and stand with me. Lift your hands and praise the Lord. Magnify him. He's worthy. He's available. He's able. The wind is blowing. Amen. The sun is shining. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for the healing power of God in this house, for the delivering power of God in this house. If you need a healing, I want you to just come. Well, run up here, but get up here, because God is going to heal some people this morning. He's going to touch and encourage some people. He's already doing. Things are being lifted off your shoulder, off of your heart, and off of your life. Spirits are leaving you that have been working on you and badgering you. You've been delivered by the power of God. Come on and lift your hands. Oh, yeah. Available to us. Oh, we bless you, Lord. We bless your mighty name, your mighty name. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for your grace and for your mercy. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you. I dare you just to walk with me down here and back. I double dare you just to walk down here with me and back. Walk with me and back. I dare you to open this door.
Amen.
I dare you to open this door and say, devil, get out of here. And you
say, devil, get out of here.
Yeah, well, he was already gone. He was already gone, but I want you to say it. Amen. Oh, now, how about walking back to the other side of this place? It's all right. You can sit down if you want to. Yeah. You were there when I needed you. You get a break here. Amen. All right. Amen. Amen. Yes. I want you to lay your hands on this pulpit.
Yes.
I want you to lay your hands on that singing pulpit. Amen. Or whatever it needs to be. Just believe that God is going to use whoever's behind here and there and sings there. The quality is going to be good. And the power is going to be real. And God is going to produce in us what needs to be in Jesus' name. And Jesus, Sister Catherine, God, I believe, is going to touch you this morning. I believe God's going to touch you this morning. Sister Peggy, just put your hand on her. Both of you, y'all just reach out for her. You don't have to do anything crazy. Just claim it. We claim 1, 2, 3. We agree. You agree too? In the name of Jesus. Oh, yes, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We bless you, Father. We praise you, Father. Brother Willie, come here. You need a touch from God. You're a good man. You love God. But I just saw it on you. You need a touch from God. Somebody help me pray for Brother Willie. Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Go ahead, Brother James. Lay one on him, brother. Lay one on him in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God.
Thank you,
you're worthy. You're
Father, in the name of the brother Jesus, I pray for my brother right now. I release super anointing on my brother. Release that anointing in the mighty name of the brother Jesus. And bring out those gifts in him. Let him see the gifts that you have given him. And you don't repent of your gifts. You have given this brother gifts and helped him to see what they are. Show him. Give him revelation knowledge of each and every gift. And give him supernatural strength by the blood of Jesus Christ. By the blood. Plead the blood over my brother. Plead the blood over him and his family. Protect them and keep them safe. In the mighty name. In the blood of Jesus Christ.
Here's the drink that will flush sugar from your veins and make poor circulation disappear.
Bless you, brother. Bless you. Bless you, man. Bless you. Oh, yes.
Thank you, Father. Would you just repeat this after me and say it your own way? Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
We want your kingdom to come.
We want your kingdom to come.
We want you to be our king.
We want you to be our king.
You're our Lord and Savior.
You're our Lord and Savior.
And we declare today, you are also our king.
You're also our king.
Of the kingdom.
Of the kingdom.
That you're in charge.
You're in charge.
And we feel good about it.
We
believe in the kingdom.
We believe in the kingdom.
And that God is there.
And
the kingdom is moving. It's picked up speed in these last days. And it's coming our way. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Bless you, Lord. Yes. Amen. Thank you, Father. we can get it. We've got it. It belongs to us, brother. He's made it available. Jesus himself is the main key. Thank you, Father, for being the door for us and for the keys that you give us, because we're yours and you trust us. You say, we're trustworthy. He says, you're trustworthy. You can use the key. Use it any time you want to. You won't ever do anything wrong with it. But you'll just be a blessing. You're going to be one of the keys. One of the keys to the kingdom. Thank you. Oh, it's communion time. Yes. We're going to have communion. Amen. Praise the Lord. Be glad you don't have to hear my song. I actually got a what I would call the hymn of the kingdom. It's a 1980 song. Yeah. I'm working on it. You know, when you can't sing, you got to be anointed when you sing. Is that right?
Yes.
Aren't you glad he anoints me? Sometimes when I sing, sometimes he says, why don't you go sing somewhere else? Like in the woods. No. Okay, so, excuse me.
Thank you, Jesus. As we get ready to partake of our communion, I want to share with you a story, a true story. And this, the title of this is Mercy, Grace, and Righteous Encounter. Fiery Ola LaGuardia famously served as the mayor of New York City from 1934 to 1945. A story is told of him showing up at night court one brutally cold January night, dismissing the sitting judge and presiding over the criminal cases himself. A case number was rattled off, and a woman who was accused of stealing bread from a local grocery store was brought before the court. When given a chance to state her defense, the haggard mother pled guilty, explaining why she had committed the crime. Her husband had deserted her, her daughter was sick, and her grandchildren were hungry. The owner of the grocery store was in attendance that night to press charges. It's a bad neighborhood, Your Honor, the owner said. She has to be punished to teach other people around here a lesson. LaGuardia thought a minute before rendering his sentence. Justice was required, and there was no doubt the woman was guilty of the crime. I have to punish you, the mayor turned judge proclaimed. The law makes no exception. $10 or 10 days in jail. But even as the mayor declared his sentence, the courtroom fell to a hush as he reached into his own pocket, extracted a $10 bill. Here is a $10 fine, which I now remit. We are the woman who has committed a crime. We messed up in our lives. We're guilty. Justice demands a verdict. The difference is we don't even need an accuser present to point out our indiscretion. We know them full well. We remind ourselves daily of what we've done, how we failed, when we've let others down, and why we're deserving of punishment and not forgiveness. But the gospel tells us that rather than we pay for our sin, Jesus paid for them himself.
Amen.
On the cross of Calvary, God's mercy provided what his own justice demanded. Isaiah, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, prophesied about Jesus' substitutionary atonement 700 years before Jesus' day of sacrifice. He wrote of Jesus. He was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Amen.
And as we partake of this communion today, justice demanded a payment, but mercy paid it all.
Amen.
And as we partake of this communion today, that this bread symbolizes his broken body.
Amen.
That was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him.
Amen.
As we partake of this bread. So let us partake together. Because there was nothing that we could do to pay for our sin, Jesus said, I paid it all. I paid it all. And he did. And praise be to God that he did. The scripture said, then also he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. And folks, when I think about this and what Jesus did for me and for all of us, yeah, there is nothing, there's no amount of money that could do it, but his blood could do it for our sins. And let us drink together.
Amen.
And let us pray.
Amen.
Our merciful Heavenly Father, as we come before you, and as Jesus did so many years ago on behalf of all of us as sinners, he paid it all, God, and you received it. And today, we can reminisce and we can partake of this communion because of what Jesus did. Nothing, Lord, nothing that we could do, but you did it all, Jesus. And we thank you. You declared us free, free from sin.
Amen.
Lord, you said our sins was as crimson, but you would make us as white as snow. And you did that with your blood, the blood of the precious Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, our Savior. And Father, we just want to say thank you today. Thank you that we have it written down, Lord. It's written on our hearts, which is most important, that we remember and that we acknowledge what you've done for us, and we let us never forget, but always remember what you've done, Jesus. So as we partake of this communion, Lord, it's for the healing of our bodies, the healings of our souls, the healing of our spirit, God. And we want to live in that kingdom that Pastor Ben has talked about. We want to walk in that kingdom each and every day of our life. We want to be kingdom believers. We want to be kingdom walkers, Lord, kingdom talkers. We want to be those people that can tell other people about you, Jesus, and show them the way into the kingdom. Because Jesus has done it all. He's paid it all. And we are that light that shines in darkness. So help us to be the people that you've called us to be, and be that light that shines in a dark world. And Lord, you are coming back soon. You're coming back soon. There's no doubt about it. And we welcome you. And Lord, as we go out into the fields and work in the harvest, let us lead others to you and tell them how great and wonderful you are, because you are. We bless you today. We thank you today for dying for us and living for us and making intercession for us right now. And Lord, we just lift up your name, Jesus, as we give you praise. And as we do this in remembrance of all that you've done for us. And Father, we ask and we pray this prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.